Grace Memorial. Welcome to morning prayer. Welcome to Sunday morning. Glad you're here with us. Thank you, Katie and Connie and Elizabeth, for providing music this morning. Always lovely. Katie, we can't get you on camera, but I think that might be what you wanted. But welcome to morning prayer. The easiest way to follow along with us, of course, is to look at the digital bulletin at gracelynchburg.org. You can always print it out. Most everything you need if you have a book of common prayer can also be found there, beginning on page 79. One note, next Sunday, we will begin streaming on YouTube instead of Facebook. You can still find a link to the service on Facebook. It'll be right up on top if you go to our Facebook page or see on our website. But there will be a dedicated link that will get you to that streaming video. So we hope that allows more people to connect and the connection to be more stable and things like that. So we're always trying to find the best way. So be patient as we change things now and then, as we try to find the best way to stay connected as a community in these days. But we're glad that you're here, and we hope that it is easy to connect. If you have any prayer requests, let us know either in the chat or by sending an email. And if we can, we'll include them in our prayers today, but definitely through the prayers of this community going forward. But we begin with the confession of sin after the opening sentence. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil that we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. Let's say the invitatory psalm together with the antiphon at the beginning and the end. The Holy One is in our midst. O come, let us worship. O God, you are my God. Eagerly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you. As in a barren and dry land where there is no water, therefore I have gazed upon you in your holy place, that I might behold your power and your glory. For your loving kindness is better than life itself. My lips shall give you praise. So will I bless you as long as I live, and lift up my hands in your name. My soul is content, as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praises you with joyful lips. When I remember you upon my bed, and meditate on you in the night watches. For you have been my helper, and under the shadow of your wings I will rejoice. My soul clings to you, your right hand holds me fast. The Holy One is in our midst. O come, let us worship. The psalm appointed for today is a portion of Psalm 103. And let's say it responsively by half verse. So it puts a little bit of pressure on those who are here. But responsively by half verse. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. He forgives all your sins, and heals all your infirmities. He redeems your life from the grave, and crowns you with mercy and loving kindness. He satisfies you with good things, and your youth is renewed like an eagle's. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all who are oppressed. He made his ways known to Moses, and his works to the children of Israel. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and of great kindness. He will not always accuse us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our wickedness. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so is his mercy great upon those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our sins from us. As a father cares for his children, so does the Lord care for those who fear him. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We continue with the readings.
What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him? So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him, and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's say together the first canticle, which is Canticle J, a song of Judah. I will sing a new song to my God, for you are great and glorious, wonderful in strength, invincible. Let the whole creation serve you, for you spoke and all things came into being. You sent your breath and it formed them. No one is able to resist your voice. Mountains and seas are stirred through their depths. Rocks melt like wax at your presence. But to those who fear you, you continue to show mercy. No sacrifice, however fragrant, can please you. But whoever fears the Lord shall stand in your sight forever.
A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day observe it in honor of the Lord. Also, those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then, each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let's say together Canticle 21, the Te Deum. You are God, we praise you. You are the Lord, we acclaim you. You are the eternal Father, all creation worships you. To you, all angels, all the powers of heaven, cherubim and seraphim, sing in endless praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. The glorious company of apostles praise you. The noble fellowship of prophets praise you. The white-robed army of martyrs praise you. Throughout the world, the Holy Church acclaims you. Father of majesty unbounded, your true and only Son, worthy of all worship, and the Holy Spirit, Advocate and God. You, Christ, are the King of glory, the eternal Son of the Father. When you became man to set us free, you did not shun the virgin's womb. You overcame the sting of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. You are seated at God's right hand in glory. We believe that you will come and be our judge. Come then, Lord, and help your people, bought with the price of your own blood, and bring us with your saints to glory everlasting.
A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed. And they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This conversation that Peter has with Jesus right before he tells this parable is one that I can definitely relate to. You know, right before that, in the lessons that we had last week, Jesus tells us what to do in community when people are outside of the community, how to draw them back in into that relationship of the body, to the relationship of the whole, which is like our relationship with God. And walking away from that conversation, Peter's mind starts to turn. It's like, all right, well, what does that mean for me in my own life? If we're going to be always welcoming people back, how often should I forgive somebody who's wronged me personally? And he's been following Jesus around for a while, and he thinks he's got the answer. And he says, "I know, probably 7 times, right? That's plenty. That's a lot." You know, and of course he's disappointed with the answer because Jesus says not 7, but this ridiculous amount. Take whatever you're imagining that you have to do to look like God and multiply it by infinity, and that's kind of the way that forgiveness should come out of your life if you've been connected with God. I can just imagine him saying, patting himself on the back, Peter, saying, "Yeah, 7, I've got this." And he hears Jesus, it's like, "Oh, more than 7? How much more?" "Oh, that much more." That's a lot. I wonder if he got it then, or if he struggled with it. I wonder if he went home trying to figure out what it meant. If he tried to say, "Well, all right, does that mean that I have to forgive them X amount of times until it's right?" Because Jesus didn't have to answer in a number. Jesus was giving him another mini parable of saying, this enormous amount of forgiveness should be coming from you as a follower of me. But what if Jesus had answered in a word? Maybe he would have said to Jesus' question, "How often should I forgive someone who's offended me?" What if Jesus had said, "Enough times. You forgive them as many as it takes. You forgive them always." That's sort of what he's saying. He's not giving a number as if there's a certain pattern to do it, but that our lives, when we come into connection with the divine, the God that we know about and have revealed to us through Jesus, when we come to that encounter with God, that our life, our faithful life, looks like a posture of forgiveness. Always. You know, it is ironic a little bit that we as Christians claim that our identity as Christians, often we use that word forgiven. We know that we are people who have been forgiven. And yet we are called to be a people who are forgiving. We are called to extend what we have received out into the world. The Christian community that gathers in the name of Jesus is called to be a community that extends God's forgiveness out. And Jesus says that when we put a limit on it, whether it's numerical or emotional or political or anything, when we put a limit on what we are receiving from God, that's when problems occur. And he tells this parable of an incredible amount of forgiveness that is extended to somebody who receives that and holds on to it so tightly that they can't extend it to someone else. Where that forgiveness that is received for them is stymied in its flow out. And a lot of us who've grown up maybe hearing this story occasionally, we get used to saying, to looking at it from an outside perspective. We look at that king and talk about how that might look a lot like God extending forgiveness to this person and how generous God is with forgiveness. And we look at the person who didn't quite get it and we say, that poor guy, he's going to get it in the end. And we forget that sometimes we've been in that place where we were so convinced of our rightness that we couldn't let go of what we've been given. We were so treasuring what we had received that we couldn't pass it forward and out into the world. We forget that we're that person. Because posturing yourself in a way of forgiving is hard. Because it's not actually just forgiveness. If you look at what Jesus is saying, it's not just what we assume as forgive and forget. Because there are some people who that comes easy to. There are some people who walk through this life and nothing much sticks to them. You know, you have that phrase like water off a duck's back. You know, they encounter a difficulty, they encounter a conflict, and they can easily let it go. And some of us, that's not the case. But that's not forgiveness. That's not the same kind of forgiveness that Jesus is talking about. Jesus is talking about a posture that in which we set aside our right and our identity for the sake of drawing that other person back to God. We've set aside ourselves for the other person. When you look at what Jesus is saying in this parable, he describes forgiveness not just as in letting it go, but in showing mercy to someone that you wouldn't want to extend mercy to. Forgiveness isn't always about an attitude. It is an extension of the kindness and the grace and the love and the mercy that we have received in our own lives. And because of that, we have this wealth of resources that we can point and direct out into the world. And it's not easy. It is hard, and it is stunning when we realize that we have to keep coming back to it, back to it, back to it, again and again. When Jesus says, you don't just do it one time, you do it as many times as it takes to restore that relationship. And what we're not saying is that people who are suffering harm at the hands of the other, that they just let that go. Verses like this have been used to justify violence in the home for centuries. It's been used to justify power dynamics that were unhealthy, that were racist, that were unsustainable. And Jesus isn't talking about that, but he's talking about the way that we move in the world, that we need to be transformed by our encounter with God in such a way that we are constantly setting ourselves aside so that God's mercy can flow through us and through this community into the world. That is what God's forgiveness and love looks like in a community that is gathered in God's name. And it's sometimes hard and it's sometimes difficult to fathom the lengths that God will continue to go to draw all people to God's self. But that's the surprising good news of this gospel. Amen. I invite you to say with me the Apostles' Creed, and if you're in the building, to stand and say it with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today your daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Help us, O God, our Savior. Deliver us and forgive us our sins. Look upon your congregation. Give to your people the blessing of peace. Declare your glory among the nations, and your wonders among all peoples. Do not let the oppressed be shamed and turned away. Never forget the lives of your poor. Continue your loving kindness to those who know you, and your favor to those who are true of heart. Satisfy us by your loving kindness in the morning, so shall we rejoice and be glad all the days of our life. O God, because without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord God, almighty and everlasting Father, you have brought us in safety to this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin, nor be overcome by adversity. Then all we do direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. O God, we give you thanks for the many ministries of this parish. And in our prayers to those we serve and support in the community, we pray for the ministry of Gleaning for the World. Remembering especially all those who have died alone and those who have died in the tragedies and the natural disasters on the West Coast, we pray for all those who have died, that they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life and light eternal. Amen. We pray also for those committed to our prayers, especially Sharon, and with extra celebration, Carter, Joseph, Joanne, Shelby, Barbara, Brandy, Betty, Gloria, Betty, Nancy, Mary Louise, Jean, Bill, Jeannie, Jerry and Glenn, Skip, Bud and Chris, Annie Bob,
Barbara, Gloria, and others we may wish to remember now. We pray, O God, that you will be present with them to comfort them in their distress, to be a strength to them in their fear, to bring them to the wholeness and strength that you desire for each of us, and to give them the joy of your salvation. Amen. Amen.
Two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them.
Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Before we dismiss, just a couple of announcements. First of all, as we mentioned at the very beginning, we'll be transitioning to the live stream on YouTube instead of Facebook, but you'll still be able to find it on Facebook. It will lead you through that, so you shouldn't miss a thing. But starting next week on Sunday, that's where the home of our live stream will be. Also, thank you so much for everyone who contributed to the fundraiser for Grace House on the Mountain. We exceeded our goals in dramatic ways. You'll hear official results later this week. But thank you. We're just thrilled that we can give an offering to them and support that vital ministry for those families in the Appalachian Mountains. In the name of Billy Young, our dear friend whom we miss so much. This next Sunday, the 20th, at 5:30, we're going to have an outdoor evening prayer, weather permitting, here at Grace. So you'll bring your camp chairs or your lawn chairs, and we'll gather for that service out on the grass. So weather permitting, 5:30 next Sunday. The Sunday after that, and you've seen some announcements so far, we're going to have a one-day food drive for the Blue Ridge Area Food Bank, and this is going to be something that everyone can participate in. So tell your friends and your neighbors. It'll be like 3 to 5 in the afternoon on the 27th. You can do a low-contact drop-off where you just drop the bags of food there, and someone else will pick it up, and we'll be delivering it with volunteers to the food bank that same day. So thank you so much for being with us. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to the generation in the church, and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen.